many people, Dave Chappelle, he's a comedian, he's an actor. For many people here, he's a neighbor. He lives just outside of the city, so the events of that day certainly hit very close to home. So he says that this is meant to really pay tribute to the memories of those nine people who died on this very street, but also to remind the rest of the country or the world that in Dayton, neighbors help neighbors. So here's a bit of the conversation that we had with him backstage. You said something out there but when things got started that I think the rest of the country would have probably been extremely excited to hear and pleased to hear, which was this is for every victim of every mass shooting in the country, but specifically because it happened on the heels of El Paso. So can you just elaborate on that a little bit? Your message to the people who may not...
I mean, I grew up in Washington, so that city always makes the news. Then I moved to New York, and that city always makes the news. And Los Angeles can't stop talking about itself. But these people are often forgotten. You know what I mean? And then something like this happens in your city, and then you think of all the other times it happened. It makes it all very real. You realize these aren't numbers. These are people's lives. And it hurts. Like, not even in a political way, but just in a human way. It's just like, yeah, hopefully that we can usher in an era where people are more kind to each other and treat each other better.
When you got that phone call that morning, Dave, what went through your mind when you found out that it happened 16 miles from your home?
I couldn't believe it. I was getting ready to go on stage. I was on tour with Joe Rogan, and I got a CNN alert on my phone that said that there was a shooting in Dayton. I didn't know the scope of it. I didn't know the size, but I didn't find out till later when I got off stage. And the next morning, I called the mayor, and, you know, this began to happen. Like, it wasn't, this happened almost immediately. Like, people around here, man, they're scrappy people. They get up and they get it done. And what they were able to do this week and the way the community's come out to support this, it's a show of force. It's like good people got to be louder than bad people. This country is filled with good people, and the good ones got to make some noise.
These are not conventional times. These are urgent times. Let's be real. These are scary times. So the hell with all those conventional things. Today I'm declaring my candidacy for President of the United States because it's time. It's time to be brave.
Former Illinois Congressman and Trump supporter Joe Walsh.
This guy in the White House is a disaster for the party and the country. We're going to get wiped out in 2020.
You called President Obama Muslim, an enemy, a traitor, and you often spoke out on racial themes. I want to show a couple of tweets that you had. We lowered the bar for Obama. He was held to a lower standard because he was black. That was just in 2017. And then a few months after that, not just President Obama, Senator Kamala Harris said something really dumb. Meh. If you're black and a woman, you can say dumb things.
What President Trump has done is, George, he's made me reflect on some of the things I've said in the past.
Did you really believe he's a Muslim?
God, no, and I've apologized for that. I helped create Trump. There's no doubt about that. The personal, ugly politics, I regret that. The intensive three-week kindergarten course introduces specially selected children from 12 to 4 years old to pistols, rifles, semi-automatics, and a rudimentary knowledge of mortars. And so I'm reading this, Michael, off of a teleprompter, and I'm thinking to myself, well, this is kind of crazy. Found out later the whole thing was a ruse, and it was a ruse probably just to get me to say some stupid things.
Yeah, for sure. Why not?
Second thoughts.
Might as well.
You have second thoughts about escalating the war?
I have second thoughts about everything.
Are you concerned about how the market is reacting?
No, the market's doing great. Our country's doing great.
The clip you showed of Trump. He looks depressed, actually, and sort of demoralized. I mean, that's not the normal Trump. He's like, yeah, you know, I don't know, I always have second thoughts. Why not? I mean, look, his economists have told him privately, we are slowing down, and we're at some risk of really toppling into a recession. His political people have told him his numbers are going down, not up. This base play he made with all the nativist rhetoric and the attacks on Elijah Cummings and on the four congresswomen did
Jewish
not
people.
Work out. And yes, the Jewish people need to be more loyal to Israel and so forth. That hasn't worked well. And I think he sees bad economic news coming and bad political news coming, and that he's a demoralized guy.
I don't see that at all. He hates being there.
That's what I would say. He does
him too much credit for these things. Look, he just hates being at these meetings. He doesn't like the dynamics that are going on there. He sees the entire array of those folks, by and large, with the except of Boris Johnson, not being favorable.
So he hates being in the White House. He hates being at those meetings.
Saying,
he hates governing.
What does
he
like?
He's really happy.
Here's
he's not a happy warrior.
Here's the reality.
Rick,
what you're seeing is a president engaged in a battle that presidents for generations have said they will fight, and none of them have. And he's going out.
You're talking
and
about China.
And he's taking on China, and he's doing it in a way that, no, some people can quibble as to whether he's doing it the right way or the wrong way, but he's doing it.
Every 8 minutes, someone in America dies from a drug overdose. Now, most of the time, it's from an opioid like heroin or illicit fentanyl, but also opioids like oxycodone or hydrocodone, the ones prescribed by doctors. Take too much of any of these opioids, and it can be deadly. That's because they all work the same way. They can dull pain and boost dopamine, giving some people a high, but it's easy to get hooked on them. Why? Well, for one, your body can build up a tolerance. The more you use, the larger dose you may need to get the same relief. Secondly, you can become dependent on them. In fact, your body releases natural opioids when you hurt yourself. But if you habitually use opioids, your body stops producing its own and relies on the drugs instead. If you try and stop then, the body goes through withdrawal. In fact, more Americans now die from opioids than from guns.